through the development of a program known as IntACom, which was started nearly 7 years ago now by a number of TWI members who wanted to improve the affordability of NDT by reducing the time that's taken to inspect complex geometry components without sacrificing any of the sensitivity that's available with existing technologies. So just as an overview of what I'm going to be discussing, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the research strategy at TWI Wales and how we decide where our research should go and what problems that we should tackle. Then talk to you a little bit about robotic inspection in the IntACom program. And within that, we'll include the challenges of through transmission scanning of parts that have non-parallel faces and have large changes in thickness. Look at imaging and software. Look at how we calibrate the tool center point on a part where we've got a water jet as part of the tool. Look at scanning of legacy parts, at photogrammetry, metrology for NDT, and look at the new system that was recently commissioned last month, and then talk to you about the opportunities that exist for taking part in IntACom 3, which is the next stage of this program due to start in December. TWI, you may or may not know well, we're a membership-based organization, and we've got five regional offices in UK. We've got our center at Cambridge, which I'm broadcasting to you from now, and four other centers in Middlesbrough, Aberdeen, Rotherham, and Portalbert. And this development work that I'm going to show you today is the result of work that's been carried out in our specialist advanced NDT center in Portalbert. So in order to work out what areas we should tackle and what our strategy should be for NDT technology development, we attend conferences and seminars and try to determine where the market is going, where the demand is likely to be, and where the challenges are. We look at papers and articles that appear. And also, of course, as a membership-based organization, we receive requests from customers and from members. And from our discussions, the areas that are presenting the biggest challenges for NDT at the moment are those in additive manufacturing, in composites, and in weld inspection. Here on the left-hand side, you can see a movie. I apologize, it's a little jerky, but that's just a function of the transfer rate that we can achieve over the web. But I think that even though the movie's jerky, it still conveys more information than a static image would do. So I apologize for that. As you can see on that screen, we're building up a component by depositing blown metal powder. And in much the same way as composite manufacture, we're actually building a part from nothing. And as we're actually constructing the part, then there's the potential to introduce flaws such as porosity. And we need to develop technologies that enable us to be able to inspect this type of component. Composites have got an awful lot of synergy with additively manufactured parts in that they're highly anisotropic in nature. The manufacturing process takes advantage of the freedoms that it gives us to produce very large components with very complex shape. And consequently, we need to develop methods of inspecting these that don't slow down the production throughput, but are still reliable and able to find the flaws that we need to find. And lastly, weld inspection. Now, when I'm talking about weld inspection, I don't necessarily mean the old stick welding that many of us have grown up with. I'm talking about the new weld inspection technologies such as laser and electron beam, and the various types of friction welding such as friction stir welding and linear and rotary friction welding. So having discovered that these three areas are going to give us the biggest challenges for NDT, we need to look at potential solutions to these challenges. And these are advanced digital radiography such as computer tomography, robotic and automated inspection systems to deal with the complex geometry and the required speed of production throughput, full matrix capture and other forms of advanced ultrasonic testing, and of course EMATs. For those of you who don't know, that's electromagnetic acoustic transducers. Of course, to underpin all that, to enable us to integrate all these technologies together within a robotic inspection cell, we're very much dependent upon software development. And at TWI Wales, we've now put together a dedicated software development team, which does two things. First of all, it enables us to do these kinds of activities without being reliant on external sources. But also it means that we're very agile and able to respond very quickly to changes that are requested by customers and members. So the IntACom program was born from these requirements, and its main aim was, as I said before, to reduce the inspection time for complex geometries without loss of inspection quality. And to enable us to do this, we need a number of automation to provide us with the dexterity and repeatability required, advanced ultrasonic inspection techniques such as phased array to be able to deal with these complex geometries, custom software to enable us to present the data that we'd acquired in a way that was meaningful and intuitive, 3D printed nozzles to enable us to convey the ultrasounds from a large probe, such as a large array probe, into the part via a water jet, and metrology solutions that enable us to check that the part is the correct part, that it's in the right place within the cell, and that it conforms to the CAD data that the system has on record. Currently, we're at the end of phase two of the program, and the partners that have been involved so far have been Rolls-Royce, GKN, Bombardier, and the Royal National Lifeboat Institution, together and supported by TWI and Welsh Government. Phase two project was valued at £1.8 million, with £60,000 per partner per year being contributed by the partner companies. It was a three-year program, and there are approximately 3 months left to run. This is due to finish now at Christmas. And IntACom 3 will then start in December of this year. So now I've got a movie that I'd like to show you. So this is the existing robotic cell that was developed as part of the IntACom 1 and IntACom 1A development. And this consists of two KR16 KUKA robots operating within a fixed cell. The robots are fixed to the floor, and they have an inspection volume that's approximately 2 meters by 1 meter by 1 meter. The robots are able to work either cooperatively, as is required for through transmission, or they can work independently, as you can see here, either inspecting different parts of the same component or indeed two different components within the same cell. The transducers in the end effectors are 64 element phased array and roughly have a width of about 2 inches. So these robots are able to scan a 2-inch wide strip at the speed that you can see here. The movie will then go on to give you a brief illustration of the data type that's produced. We felt it was very important, if we were going to produce scans of complex shaped parts, to make sure that the data was also presented in 3D. So as you will see in a moment, the screen can be manipulated and scaled and rotated in full 3D. In this case, what you're seeing is an amplitude scan of the component with a black and white color palette, but this color palette can be switched, and indeed you can import custom color palettes to make the task more easy to manage. So this screen shows a time of flight image of that same component. Here, color is representative of depth or thickness of the part. And you can see over on the left-hand side of the screen, there are a series of artificial defects that have been implanted into the part. These consist of 12, 6, and 3 millimeter square Teflon implants. And if I enlarge that, you can see that at the moment, the cursor is resting over the 3 millimeter defect, which you can see just here. And a line drawn through that part, as you can see here on the B scan, shows the top surface, the back surface, and here's the defect. And the A scan actually relates to the section through this part of the B scan. So here's the front surface, and here's the defect. And of course, the back wall indication has disappeared at this particular point. So that's all very well and very easy for simple curves, but what happens when the front and back surfaces are not parallel, and consequently we get a large change in thickness? This presents us with a different challenge, because first of all, we need to make sure that the water path remains consistent to make sure that our gating is still effective. Now, typically, one robot will mirror the actions of the other. But as you can see, if the robot scanning the lower face maintains the probe perpendicular to the surface, and the robot on the upper surface actually mirrors it, then you'll note that the probe is no longer perpendicular to the surface and is not well positioned in order to receive the emerging ultrasound. However, what we can do is we can write a separate program as part of the path planning operation, the offline path planning operation, that generates two paths. And the second robot actually changes its orientation to match the surface, but still maintains a position opposite the robot that's delivering the ultrasound. So we get effective through transmission inspection of parts with constantly varying thickness and non-parallel surfaces. And I could show you that in this movie. So here I've turned the water supply off so that you can more easily see the action of the two probes. Here you'll notice that they're maintaining coordinated position with respect to each other, but the distance between them is changing and their respective orientations is changing to accommodate the changing shape of the component under test. And this was achieved by writing a MATLAB script essentially to modify the position of the second robot. We then went on to modify the software. Additionally, we've used a point cloud type approach where each inspection point actually represents a pinprick on the surface, a point cloud, if you like. But when inspecting a component such as the one that you've just seen, there are gaps in between the two points, between any two adjacent points. And of course, the back surface is then visible through the front surface. Now, visually, this doesn't make much of a difference, but if you're trying to use a mouse to select a point on the surface, if you're not careful, you can select the back surface instead of the front surface. And also, if viewing components in high angles, high perspective angles, the size of the pixels varies across the image. The answer to that was to rebuild the software using a rendering action to tessellate the surface. So here I'm going to show you what we did with the new version of the software. So it's still scrollable, but it still follows the same basic outlet as the previous software. So we still have an A scan, we still have a B scan, and we still have a fully scrollable, rotatable, and zoomable window. But now we have a fully rendered version of the skin, and the back surface skin is now no longer visible. And we don't get this pixelization when we look at the surface with high angles of perspective. Now, you will have noticed in the last image that there was some stripiness, which is a function of a number of things. First of all, it's a function of the accuracy of the orientation of the array with respect to the surface. But it's also a function of the quality of the water jet. And designing a nozzle that can accommodate a 2-inch wide array probe is not as easy as it might seem. When we looked more carefully at the quality of the ultrasound that was being received, we noticed that some of the elements were receiving vastly different amplitudes to neighboring elements. So we engaged a program of study with Swansea University as a mechanical engineering student end of course project. And we got people who were skilled in fluid flow dynamics to reinvestigate and reanalyze the way that we designed the nozzles. Consequently, this design then changed, and the image that you can see here represents the latest iteration of nozzle design. And what I want you to notice about this is if you look at the water emerging from the end of the jet, it's almost like a piece of glass. It's got extremely good laminar flow, and it leads to a huge reduction in noise present in the image. If I run that, you can see that the water flow is really consistent and allows for really good transmission of ultrasound from the nozzle into the part. And when we actually look at the elements across the width of the array, you can see that that now produces a much more uniform amplitude across the array compared to the previous version. Here on the right side, you can see there's a slight dip in amplitude. This is the top of the array, and of course we've got some issues there because the water pressure changes very slightly across the array, but there'll be more on that later on when I come to explain the new pumping system that we've put in place. Another factor that affects the stripiness on the image, the stripiness that we want to remove, is the alignment of the tool with respect to the surface. And the traditional way of doing that is to put a pointer onto the end of the array probe and then to align that with the surface and do a visual calibration of the tool. However, what that doesn't take into effect is the effects of the water jet. So what we really needed was a two-point calibration that would allow us to carry that out with the water flowing. Consequently, we developed a technique of imaging a sphere from several different orientations, and by writing a MATLAB program, we were able to determine from the ultrasonic information where the tool point, where the tool center point was, and hence do a more accurate tool calibration. And this is done automatically and in a fraction of the time that it takes to do a manual calibration. Another problem, of course, if you're going to use robots to inspect a component, you need accurate CAD data to enable you to generate a scan path that covers the whole area of the part without colliding with it. Sometimes clients bring samples for which the CAD data has been lost or for which CAD data doesn't exist, or indeed the part may be of a different shape to that shown in the CAD data. It became important to us to be able to determine what the actual shape of the component is. And in order to do that, we integrated a 2D laser profile with the robot system. This can provide us with an accuracy of 0.2 of a millimeter. And the laser can move quite quickly as it operates at a frequency of 1200 hertz. So in order to prove this system, we carried out a scan of a step wedge. As you can see, the image produced was as below, and that then led to us being able to scan components such as this complex shape, single shot molded carbon fiber sample you can see on the left, and that then generated the image on the right, which could then be imported into the robot cell and enable us to generate a scan path. So the next challenge for us then is, robots often don't follow the predetermined scan path that you ask them to follow. They always do the same thing, pretty much, within very small variation, maybe 50 microns or so, but they often don't go exactly to the demanded position. Now, this is particularly important when we're trying to carry out through transmission scans. But of course, you've got two robots working, and if neither of them are following the demanded scan path, the variation in position can result in very large variations in amplitude that are not due to the effects from the part itself. One way to deal with this is to use photogrammetry or motion capture technology. So much in the same way as the sporting fraternity use these types of system to analyze a golf swing. We can put reflectors onto the robot and onto the part and onto the jigging and fixturing to monitor relative positions. And in this case, we procured a Qualisys system together with 8 cameras that can track thousands of points all at the same time. No elephants were harmed in the making of this video, I have to say. The advantage of the camera system that was chosen was, first of all, they're fully waterproof to IP65, so working in the robot cell where we're squirting a lot of water around. This was felt to be very important. And also, they can either be mounted in fixed positions or they can be mounted on tripods, such as shown in the image on the left-hand side. Now, the accuracy that's available within the tracking environment varies, so it's important to determine what accuracy is required over a particular area, and you can then change the camera arrangement to make sure that you actually get the accuracy required within the area in which it's needed. It then occurred to us, of course, that it's not necessarily, we don't necessarily need the robots to move the transducer. Previously, the robots have been used because they have encoding systems that enable you to accurately track position. But if we're using the photogrammetry system to track the position, then we can use any mechanism to move the transducer around the area of interest. And in this case, we chose a handheld system and 3D printed a holder to which we could affix three reflective spheres. And this then enables us to monitor the position of the probe with 3 degrees of freedom. And this is particularly useful if we want to scan components that either won't fit into the cell or that are now in service, where they've moved from the manufacturing site, and perhaps an aircraft has sustained damage during flight, or perhaps we want to monitor, as in this case, the condition of the hull of a boat that has seen service in order to facilitate a life extension. In this particular instance, we traveled to the boatyard and took a series of cameras. Here you can see there are four cameras mounted on tripods. Once the cameras are mounted and set up, it's a simple matter to run a self-calibration routine such that the cameras all determine where they are in space and establish a global coordinate reference system. We then attach markers to the boat and again run the calibration, and that then establishes the position of the component under test within that same coordinate referencing system. We can then scan and record and encode the position of the probe as we complete the scans. The good thing about this process is that it uses the IntACom software, and so images that are recorded in service can be directly compared with those that were acquired during manufacture. Here's a typical image from the software, from the IntACom software for freehand scanning. The only difference really between this and the robotic system is that over here on the top right-hand corner, you can see another box. What this box is showing, in green is the area that you've scanned, and in red is the area that's yet to be scanned. So it enables you to keep track of the coverage that you've achieved as you scan. Again, the main image on the screen is a live 3D image, and it can be zoomed and scrolled and rotated as required. This is a typical image of a component, and although this is a flat plate, it could be any shape almost, but you can see that the imagery that's produced is comparable with other typical 3D encoded scanning systems and looks virtually identical to the IntACom software that we developed for the robotic system. The next phase of the program was to take the technology that had been developed for the small cell and expand that to cope with larger parts such as wing skins, wing turbine blades, wing spars, and other large panels. So the plan was to develop a system that had tracks to enable us to scan long components. Here you can see this schematic illustrates two larger robots. These are KR120s on two 10-meter tracks. And also at the end of the cell, you'll see that there's a turntable. And this allows us to scan cylindrical objects up to 4 meters in diameter. Or anything, in fact, not just cylindrical objects, but anything that we can put on a turntable and rotate to facilitate easier scanning. We began the installation of the system in May of this year, and here you can see the work as it was progressing during the installation. And now the system has been fully commissioned, and hopefully this animation will run and show you what some of the intended uses of the system are. Again, I apologize for the jerkiness, but this movie is available on the TWI website where it will run more smoothly. So please follow the links on the TWI website and this and other movies that you've seen earlier on in the presentation. So here you can see a schematic illustration of the ultrasound system. So the sound waves are being transmitted through the water to the back wall of the component and being reflected back to the probe. Of course, if we introduce a defect, then the sound arrives back at the probe in a shorter time because it's not had to travel so far. And if we know what the speed of sound is in the part, then we can generate a false color map, either based on the amplitude of the reflected signal or based on the thickness of the material. Of course, it doesn't have to be a round component. It can be any shape. And in this case, we're illustrating something that looks like a turbine blade. And in this final case, we're just looking at a complex piece of waffle structure that might be used to reinforce another type of structure. And again, the image is displayed in 3D, fully scrollable, rotatable, and zoomable. So here's what the final cell looks like. You can see there's a master robot high on a staging on the right-hand side, a slave robot on the opposite side, a fixture table, and a turntable. We finished commissioning of the system just a week or so ago, and the first data that was acquired using the new system can be seen in a couple of seconds. So just a summary then, there are two KR120 robots. These are mounted on two tracks. There's a 4 meter diameter turntable. And the pull to receiver system that we're using at the moment is Peak NDT's LTPA. Again, this system is IP65, and so it can be mounted directly on the robots without fear of spoiling the system due to water ingress. And this reduces the amount of noise that we experience due to electronic interference from the robot systems and other nearby cabling. Ethernet connections are provided to connect the LTPAs, and they are actually powered by power over Ethernet, so we don't need to run any mains cables through the conduit. The new flow system, because the robots are able to reach over 4 meters in height, we needed to be able to cope with variations in pressure from the pumps, and this necessitated the installation of flow meters to monitor and constantly vary the flow in order to maintain a constant flow rate. And there's a separate pumping station and a separate programmable logic control unit that controls all aspects of the water pumping system. So here you can see the new system scanning the same component that you saw in the cell right at the beginning of the presentation. Again, sorry for the jerkiness. The image that I'm seeing on my screen in front of me isn't jerky at all, so I apologize. It's just a vagary of the web-based webcasting system that we're using. The very large end effector that you can see on the robot is because this was actually developed for a different component where we need to reach into a tight space. And we need that additional reach on the end of the end effector, but all these end effectors are interchangeable, and we can put any other shape of arm on the end of the robot to enable us to accomplish whatever scanning task is presented to us. Just a bit of a close up to the end effector. Here you can see there's a flow meter integrated on the left hand side of the right-hand image. You can see the 3D printed probe and nozzle, and of course the tool holder extension that connects to the part. Incidentally, there's always it doesn't matter how careful you are, but there's always a chance that you might collide with the part if something goes wrong. And consequently, the end effector is connected to the robot with a magnetic coupling system that uses a permanent magnet. And in the event of a collision, the end effector will detach from the robot to avoid damaging the part. And this is typical of the result system. So as you can see, looks very much the same as what was generated in the small cell. You can see an A scan and a B scan, and you can see the back wall and the front wall of the part, and of course here you can see a defect present. The IntACom 3 proposal for the next phase of the work is currently being drafted. Again, it aims at 60k per partner per year for 3 years. CWI contributes 120k per year, and historically Welsh Government has matched that, and we hope that we can achieve that in the next phase of the programme too. So in other words, for 180k of investment over your 3 years, what you actually get is £1.8 million worth of research, which is 10-to-1 gearing, which I think is extremely competitive. And what's really good about the programme is that the partners get to determine what the scope of work is. So at the moment, if you've seen anything in the IntACom programme that piques your interest, you'd like to join the programme and have some input to the work or to the samples or to the direction of the project, then my contact details appear at the end. Please feel free to give me a call and we can discuss it further. In the meantime, thank you very much for your attention. Thank you for listening. And I'm happy to take any questions you might have.
Thank you, Ian. If anybody does want to ask any questions, please use the question and answer facility that you should be able to see on your screen. Thank you. You can always email Ian directly if you wanted to ask any questions at a later date. And we will also be sending out a recording of this webinar with the presentation in the next few days. Okay, everybody, it appears that nobody wants to ask any questions. Obviously, Ian's presentation was very clear to everybody. So I hope you've enjoyed this webinar. And if you did want to ask any questions, as I say, please email Ian directly. Thank you.